I know that it's lazy Sunday, and especially during this holiday season, we are not in good shape to hear somebody. But let me assure you, today what I'm going to talk to, and it's fluid conversation. There is no PPT, there is no presentation. It's a conversation. So the basic objective of this overall, the talk and the webinar, to help you understand where the industry is going. Where can you make more money in 2021? Essentially mean that what are the role those are emerging, that is niche, where you can make a lot of money. But more than that, it's very much important where we can survive and sustain in 2021 in the age of digital disruption. So essentially mean that how to stay relevant and competitive by upgrading or maybe accelerating our role in the career in 2021. This is what we are going to achieve in today's talk. As I said, this is a conversation where I'll be sharing my perspective, and I will be opening even, in fact, you can also share your perspective. So a quick intro, I think my name is Madan Upadhyay, and I'm a digital transformation consultant. Since last 3.5 years, I'm working into this space, but more than that, I'm more passionate about people. So when I said passionate about people, I love helping the people to transition their career wherever I'm working. So I'm working into digital transformation space, into process innovation and process automation. At the same space, this is pretty hot. And that's where I help the people to move forward into this space. So for the interest of everybody here, Anshuman, from your experience, when I teach and help the people for career transformation, I typically say there are three different kinds of role into, especially into consultant space, that is emerging. One is, digital strategist, or you say AI strategist, who are very deep core into technology, especially into AI space, who know technology better than anybody else. By looking at your profile and what I help the people to understand, another domain that is emerging is a domain expert. I mean, digital transformation, but very, very specific, having deep knowledge into domain. So for example, finance and accounting transformation consultant, supply chain management, digital supply chain management consultant, or maybe HR analytics consultant, maybe logistics consultant, who know the technology at the very high level, but they have very deep domain knowledge and they know how to transform the business by leveraging the digital. So what's your view? What's your perspective on this thought process? How do you see the people who are coming from operation and the business, they can get it into this space?
Okay, this is an interesting thought. Domain-wise, yes, we have a huge experience and knowledge in the finance and accounts domain. But at the same time, we do understand that just having the domain knowledge or just having the domain experience is not enough, because the consulting is something which is a huge space, and it's not only for small fries like us. So we need to upgrade, definitely, without a doubt. So we are still wondering what are the technologies or tools that we need to upgrade to become a good or a successful consultant.
Sure. So it's a good question, but at the same time, it's a good insight. What you pointed out, that only having the domain knowledge, if somebody has very deep domain knowledge into finance and accounting, that's not enough into consulting space. Rather, they need to upgrade into technology. But bigger question comes, Anshuman, people ask how much to go deep dive. I mean, how much to go in depth in order to learn the technology. In my view, they need to learn the TSEP skill. Very strong, deep knowledge. At the same time, from technology perspective, AI perspective, they need to learn the pain point, how to identify the pain point, translate challenges into opportunities, map to the respective tools, and then calculate the overall ROI. That includes your total cost of ownership, licensing, development cost, and then present this ROI to the business use case. So this is what the skill set part of the strategy we need to learn. Coming back to technology, let me address this one. Hope this is making sense to you, Anshuman.
It does. So, whatever you have said absolutely makes sense. But then I can summarize whatever you have said into one single word, and that is data.
Yeah. So, not only data, I'm coming back to this one. I talked about mostly the strategy from technology perspective, but when we talk about digital, it's very, very vague and very vast field. From where to get started, that is the bigger question. So in my view, look at here, in my view, the way to get started is what Gartner has predicted. Due to COVID, actually it has accelerated the speed of overall digital transformation and innovation. And what companies are doing, they are mostly focusing on automating their transactional activities by improving the people's productivity. And that's where hyper-automation comes into handy. And this is the low-hanging fruit because this is all part of low-code and no-code. So if you wish to get your digital journey started, digital transformation journey started, the best place to start is RPA. RPA, I'm not sure how many of you really know about RPA. This is robotic process automation. And why I'm proposing RPA? Because it's a low-hanging fruit. So if you go to finance and accounting, if you go to supply chain management, you go to BFSI, you go to insurance, you will find enough number of use cases, and today industry is pretty excited about RPA. And that's where you can get your journey started, number one. Number two is once you are done with RPA and you are able to create opportunity for yourself, there is no point you learn and then you are not able to create any opportunity. If you create opportunity for yourself, then move, take this journey to the next level into intelligent automation space. And today industry is calling it intelligent automation, hyper automation, or some people are calling it, hyper intelligent automation. So intelligent automation is about solving the more complex problem by amalgamating RPA and artificial intelligence. And moreover, so guys, please pause me, interrupt me in case you are not following me. I would love to have this, conversation going on. Okay, so as I was talking about to get it into digital transformation step, the first step is get it into process automation space by leveraging RPA. Number two is leveraging the intelligent automation like NLP, chatbot, process mining, OCR. And then the third stage that comes into this overall digital transformation space is predictive analytics. So then that is the machine learning, deep learning, and whatever you think about it, mostly the business analytics. So these are the three steps we should be adopting and embracing as a small capsule in order to create a MVP for ourselves and see what is working and what is not working for ourselves. Okay, somebody requested to repeat once again. Okay. But yeah, I'll repeat once again. Just quickly check with everybody. Have you heard correctly or shall I repeat once again? I could not hear anything, so I'm a little doubtful. Really, I'm audible or not audible? I'm visible or not visible? Can you please confirm? Am I audible? Can you please type Y or N into the chat box? Am I audible? Okay, great. So look here. What I said, today industry is talking about loud and clear. Great, thank you. Today, industry is talking about digital transformation, but digital transformation is very, very subjective, trust me. And it's very vast. It's not easy to get your journey started and wait for 1 year to get the key results. But my view and my suggestion to you, mostly I advise to mid to senior level managers how to transition, is to create a small capsule size, valuable MVP for your career, and then get started and see maybe 2 to 3 months, you try and test what is working and what is not working for you. So one small capsule, this is maybe 2 months to 3 months of time, what you can start your journey with RPA, robotic process automation. And this is one of the topmost investment happening in the industry into this space. And the reason being that today CXOs are excited to save, free some of their OPEX, take the money out of that one, and then invest into the innovation space. And this has the capability. And why industry is more excited? Because ROI is quick. In RPA, ROI is 6 months to 9 months, or maximum is 15 months. So this is number one step. I think you should be starting your journey with RPA. Number two, once you think this is the right path, then you enter into intelligent automation space and then take your RPA journey to the next level. Like you try to amalgamate and integrate RPA with machine learning. So in machine learning also, it's very huge. So where to get started? First thing is NLP, natural language processing. Number two, you get it started with chatbot. And number three is OCR. And number four is process mining. And I think if you get a good grasp on all these four things, what I said, I think this is enough to kickstart and step into a digital space by amalgamating and complementing your existing space. So this is what I suggested. And step three, that is the more advanced step, is get it into business analytics. So that is the predictive analytics. So once you automate simple processes, step one. Step two, when you solve more complex problem, automate more complex processes. And number three, when you help the business to have the informed decision by leveraging the data, now it's a complete package. This is a complete package, and this is how you should be embarking your journey, step-by-step process, rather than taking a monolithic and the big step. Any question on this one? How many of you think it's making sense, you are getting it, or any question? I think Binay is here, he's from Process Automation. Excuse me, I think just one minute. Sorry guys, I can see Binay is here from Process Delivery Automation into banking domain. Any thought on Binay, how people should be stepping up their career into digital space? Any thought process?
Yes, Madan. If I look at it, if I compare the situation, say a couple of years, or 3 years back, RPA was the only focus because most of the customers were in early stage of, adopting to the automation and this concept. And there were, set of people issues as well to address in terms of job losses and all that.
Yeah.
Now, most of the customers, at least enterprise customers, I would say, have crossed that stage. And what I see is, again, I'm not sure. I mean, I don't want to dilute the importance of RPA. But at the same time, what is happening is, in case of RPA, especially for these large enterprise customers, they are seeing challenges with RPA. So they think that it is only tactical. And once you plan your bots or any RPA, they are also thinking about when you will decommission it. When I say decommission, in the sense, one of my customers, they straight away have a plan to, they say, okay, RPA fine, but in 1.5 year or 2 years down the line, what is the plan of replacing RPA with, say, core application changes?
That's correct.
So what slight shift which I see nowadays is, RPA still remains part of the game, but it is not only the preferred option. So in some cases, I see the priority is given to, core application changes. And, then it's a time to market kind of decision. For example, sometimes there is a regulatory pressure. You need to have certain automation in place in, say, 8 months. or six yeah. months, then obviously RPA keys in. But then eventually, you know, it gets replaced with some core application level transformation. So that yeah. is, Madan, I think we are at that crossroad where, you know, people, I know RPA, there is a certain hype cycle and people get hang on to RPA. But that may not be the only answer. That's the trend which I am observing. I mean,
you are right. You are right. So insights. It's a very interesting, you know, insight, Vinay. I mean, looking at the characteristic of RPA, it's kind of, you know, tactical approach to time to market, as you rightly said. If you have compliance issue, regulatory issue, or might be you might have pretty legacy applications and you want to, you know, improve the customer experience or you want to do quickly something, then it's a good kind of patching solutions that you can deploy and time to reduce time to market. But that is not the only solution. It's a kind of one of the toolkit into enterprise landscape.
Yes, Madan.
Yeah, great. So this is great insight. And if anybody else here who are walking into this space would like to give insight, but what, Vinay, I was addressing the people, especially I'm addressing today the people side of, you know, people yes, side of yes. transformation, from where to get started, right?
Right.
So what I experience, the people who are from strategic, from project management, or purely from the domain and business consultant side, if they can get their journey started, what I talked to the three different, you know, the steps. One is RPA. Number two is intelligent automation, especially NLP, OCR, chatbot, and process mining. And then take the journey to the further advanced level into predictive analytics. So I think the step-by-step process will help the people to at least enjoy their journey, celebrate the success, and move into this space. This is what I was addressing, the people side of the journey.
Madan, one more thing. I mean, I would like to hear it from you definitely, and as well from others. Is yeah. should see, because typically what has been happening, especially for, you know, say large investment banks or insurance companies or any large enterprise customers, it's typically the way they are organized is one is operations pillar, one is IT pillar, right? So does it make sense, or does it happening to see that there is a different organization which is coming into picture, something like OpsTech, so which is kind of an amalgamation of operations as well as technology. And that is where yeah. I think the challenge exists for probably most of us. And I mean, to be frank with me as well, because I come from typical IT services background. Now, here the challenge is I am not the operations guy, right? So now I think there is a requirement, looks like, where, you know, we have to become kind of a ops come technology kind of person. And similarly, I think probably to my operations counterparts also, they also need to understand the, you know, technology tools or automation space better rather than just focusing yeah. on core mundane operations.
Yeah. So I think this is a great insight sharing between you and me. But anybody else would like to, rather than I answer, I have a story to share here, what happened with one of my customer. But anybody would like to share their perspective on what Vinay point out here?
It's an age-old question, to be very honest. Going into the from the process side to the IT side, or from the IT side to the process side. So there is a competition always, and that will remain. Now, the person or the professionals who are in the IT side and they have been doing the coding, they would definitely, they do not welcome people from process side with such an open mind. And that's truth. So that becomes our job even more difficult, because we have to work. We'll have to work together. Otherwise, the project will not be a success. Now there is a tendency in a project where people from the IT side or people from the process side, they tend to show or prove that they are better, and without them the project is incomplete. So that thing will remain, Madan and Vinay.
Yeah.
So that will not change much. So the bridging of the gap is very, very important, and that's the reason even we have seen that the folks, the IT folks, they have also trying to understand what the process is all about.
Hmm.
And the process, and for us, the consultants, even though we don't code, but then we have to understand each and every technology. Without that, we'll not be able to finalize the solution. And as you said, regarding the low-hanging fruits and RPA, to an extent, you are right. But then I'm currently working on a big-scale transformation project. So the customers, they are not only interested in the low-hanging fruit. The customers now, they want a total digitalization or a total change, a total revamp of the entire process, starting from start to end. So I can talk from the finance background. It's starting from purchase to report, everything. Mm. Okay, so RPA is good, but then as I said earlier, the data or insights of the data is very important, Madan. Because yeah, without knowing exactly where the problem is, we might, suggest some of the tools, but then that will only give 10% or 20% of the advantage.
Yeah.
Because I have seen that practically, without understanding the entire process and the challenges. Yeah. So that's all I had to say.
Sure. It's a good insight. I mean, always tussle between IT and operation, but I would like to share one of my customer story. So they are very huge. I mean, global presence in manufacturing. So one day, director of procure to pay, I mean, they are primarily on Oracle platform. He called me one day and said, look, Madan, so what I want to do actually, I mean, my IT and operation, I don't want to create a separate team for RPA and you know, the other automation folks, but rather I want to bring you guys part of my COE and kind of, you know, build a model of, you know, build, scale and transfer model. And I want my people to upskill and let them automate their own processes, because what I know, they know best their processes. And today it's not about much of the coding, but rather I know if you train my people in 3 to 6 months, they will be ready and we can scale our overall operation. So what I have seen into part of that customer, it took 6 to 9 months to train, work along with those people side by side, making them empowered. And after 9 months, we have transferred. I mean, we started transferring business by business, department by department, and those operation people become expert in terms of automating their processes, maintaining, supporting. And we had minimal support in terms of whenever there is a critical issue. And that's how it happened for that customer. So Binay, have you seen such kind of movement maybe in your organization or somewhere else?
Well, Madan, I mean, my experience, I would say, see, mostly I work with BFS customers. So what has happened, Madan, is, I belong to IT services company. So The kind of engagement what we have is there are certain FTE benefits planned and all that. Okay, it's a very rosy picture, but on the ground, what happens is when it comes to actual transformation, the customer's IT has a different strategy. As I said, right, they want RPA. Sometimes they want RPA to be very minimal, and they want to focus on core application changes. And then it is a, I would say, analysis paralysis kind of situation. Oh, yeah. Where, you know, core application guys say, oh, I can do this, but then, you know, question is how much time it will take and whether it will align to our, you know, projected FT benefit sales, right? And another thing in case of RPA, Madan, I don't know if you or others have also faced this issue, is in terms of, you know, arranging the test data. Suppose there is a process, business process, for example. Now, say in banking, say there is a clearing or payment investigation process, right? There are some cross-border payments being investigated. And right now, see, the way there is large team which is doing it manually. And when we decide to automate this, the challenge which we got into was having the test data, because customer in production, all these applications on all this manual process was glued in. But in the test world, none of the applications and their environments, I mean, their test environments were in sync. So even for RPA design and development, there is a huge struggle in terms of getting the test data. And banking being very security sensitive, it is not like, okay, just replicate the production data into test and all that, right? That's not going to happen in banking world. So what happened is the test data becomes, I mean, to be frank with you, I have lost 6 months of project in getting the test data. And then obviously we ran into typical services issue where there was an effort overrun, there was a budget overrun, everybody, you know, shouting from all the angles.
Yeah.
So test data, and because see, none of these applications, and there were, almost 4 or 5 applications which were involved in the process. And none of those application owners had a budget to ensure that their test environments are in sync, matching our requirement.
Yeah.
So look at from RP angle, if I want, certain transaction ID, if I perform some step, go to next application, then that corresponding data has to be available. So it is the problem was with having a synchronized test data across various applications. So this is the issue which I see, especially in banking world, and that's the reason, when we propose RPA, there is an immediate pushback saying, no boss, we will not be able to, provide you test data. Let's explore the core application changes. And then it changes the ball game, because core application, it's not in our hands. It's some different team, right? So yeah. Then, it's altogether changes the ball.
Yeah, true. I mean, you are fixing the root cause, then there is no point deploying the RPA. But when it comes to operation where, I mean, as I said, there are different drivers, right? There are different drivers where you go and fix the issue, and then you either improve the efficiency or you save the cost, whatever you do. But you are right. These are the operational challenges along with RPA. You are right. Okay, great. So quickly I'm touching upon. So before we move forward, any question? I can see there are approximate 20 people. So any question before we move forward and talk to you, that what are the trend that is coming up in 2021? What are the roles those are emerging? Any question, please feel free to unmute or maybe ask from anybody. Here, so I can
Madan, I would like to hear, you mentioned about some operations people developing certain automation. So I see this trend, but not to the level of success which you mentioned, because in one of our customers, they have a concept of power user. So it is like some simple automation, even operations team should develop. But when it comes to IT services or typical Indian IT services provider, I don't think our operations teams are at that level to, develop those automation themselves. So, I mean, in case of very experienced operations user, probably that scenario works, because, earlier even Automation Anywhere or UiPath, they have come up with studios where, it's a low code or no code. But again, I see those most of it as a, tall promises, but I haven't seen that, because ultimately what happened was the power user concept got, I would say, defocused, because there were certain risk and issues which information security also came up with. So I would like to understand, is this trend, how is this trend there for rest of the, people or customers?
Yeah, sure. So look, Vinay, I mean, this is altogether a different model for, automating the operationalizing and automating the processes. So what I'm talking about, this model, what we have done is actually, so this is called train, deploy and transfer. So we'll create a kind of mix of the people. I mean, it's a COE mix of the people, where the people from our side, architects, developers, and the business analysts from that side, and then few of the users who will come, part of our team, we'll train them, and they all together, they will develop the processes and deploy. They will play different roles. Down the line, in 6 months, they become expert, and they will also start, picking up the small, simple processes, medium processes, deploying into production. But they will, under our supervision, our team will be helping them. But down the line, 6 to 9 months, they also become, by identifying the processes, automating and deploying into production. So this is about one customer. Couple of other stories, especially from Adani Group. I heard Adani Group, where I heard, I was part of Automation Anywhere webinar, and they shared the story that how they started, trained their operation people, bring the expert from outside. And those people, though they have messed up everything, but down the line, 6 months to 9 months, 1 year, those people are accountable and responsible to deploy the entire, operation bots into the production. So Adani Group has a complete story that completely operation people upskill themselves into this space, and they are delivering it.
Yeah, that's really interesting. Even I heard similar story for L&T.
So I think may not be very the very large big story, but I think this little bit of shift started. The operation is participating, and operation is taking a little a larger role.
Correct.
Great.
So, adding to that, Madan, what I see is, in fact, in my opinion, and it has, because I soiled my hands in a couple of engagements, and what I see is, I think the BA role, the business analyst role, ideally should belong to operations, because they are the real process SMEs. Because if you deploy, any BA from IT side, yeah, then what happens is he is not a process expert. He just documents what the process is, but by heart he doesn't know the process. So I think that awareness should be there in operations team, so that they can nominate couple of their SMEs who can act as business analysts, and that I think will really help. So where there is a sense of doing this, then probably success rate is higher. But if operations take the stand, no, we have our BAU workload, we cannot, we don't have bandwidth, then I really doubt whether, this will go forward.
Yeah, you are right. So what I was here to share, I mean, what kind of role that is emerging into 2021. So one of the thing, what I see, of course, the data is going to shine in 2021. I'll talk to you what are the different roles that is emerging. The other kind of job that will emerge in 2021 is security. Security is one of the area that is emerging, and this will be the highly paid job. The third one is cloud. Cloud is going to emerge. So people who are, especially the cloud architects, I'm hoping they will make a lot of money. When I talk about making a lot of money, a good cloud architect, at least in 2021, they make somewhere 35 lakhs to 50 lakhs per annum. This is what they are doing. Of course, automation will be one of the very preferred choice in 2021. So four things I feel: data, security, cloud, and the automation. Apart from this one, user experience, UX will be one of the most demanding field apart from this four one. These are the five things which I see part of, Gartner and what the other agencies are predicting. This is what I'm feeling this will, emerge in 2021. So the 10 roles which I documented from different survey. Number one is, of course, data architect, or maybe chief data officer or data scientist will be the very parallel role. This is the one role that will be the highly paid role in 2021. The other role, of course, database administrator, but database administrator, not about the traditional database, but the people who really manage the big data, Hadoop, or maybe Databricks, or maybe the big data, data lakes, who knows how to manage the cluster, how to do the replication and all. Number three for the business people that will emerge is the business process consultant or the maybe the business process transformation consultant. And I think Anshuman is from finance domain. This kind of role will emerge. And I have seen many people who are helping the business to transform the finance, transform the HR, transform the SCM, transform the logistics. This kind of role will emerge. So this is the space where I do see the people who are coming from operation or business, they can enter into this space. And of course, CDO, Chief Digital Officer. So I'm not sure, at least I'm not eligible and qualified for this role at this moment. But yeah, down the line, 5 years, somewhere I'll also try. Cloud architect, already I talked to you. Cloud architect is one of the most evergreen, and especially the people who are into hybrid cloud space. Gartner has predicted in 2021, hybrid cloud strategy, most of the company will be adopting. So the people who are cloud architect and or maybe the migration expert into cloud space, who knows how to establish two, three things. One is maybe the VCP. Another thing is DR, disaster recovery using cloud, or maybe the hybrid cloud approach. Such kind of people will be huge demand and they will make a lot of money. For them, I mean, 40, 50 lakhs will not be a big deal. Other demanding skill will be, though we keep talking about the challenges into this space, but RPA will be, of course, not RPA, but if you put kind of intelligent automation, you put it like hyper automation, will be more demand. So of course, RPA architects or maybe the people who are much into intelligent automation space, who can help the business to transform, or maybe the architects. Of course, architect is always in demand. Another role is CISO, Chief Information Security Officers. UX is, as I said, UX will be more and more in demand. The people who are helping to simplify the UI, or maybe the people who are expert into chatbot sides, who can, nowadays UX is getting eliminated and more there is a trend for voice-based UX. And last but not the least, may not be this is relevant for this community, but full stack developer. This is one of the emerging field, full stack developer, the people who knows how to test, how to develop, plus at the same time can cut across the multiple layers of the application, UI, who can build the microservices, who can even test, who can even deploy some level of knowledge of DevOps. So these are the 10 trends which I see that is emerging, especially into a digital space, and that will be the more demanding field. But I'm opening, this may not be complete study and complete roles, but anybody else would like to add, what do you see in 2021 that will be emerging highly paid role? Any addition here, and what is your perspective?
Madan, one role will never ever die down. It will always emerge and it will always be in demand is ERP consultant, yeah. Especially SAP.
You are right. SAP HANA, right? SAP HANA people.
Yeah.
It's a good addition. This is the 11th one. Any other addition do you think the role that will be demand, highly paid role? Any, I can see there are 18 people. Anybody else, do you think any role that will be more in demand?
Madan, what about, this is Vinay, what about a role? Because I see, ETL tools have been there for quite some time, right? But now tools like, say, Alteryx or Acceptor, they are also coming into automation space. So it is a combination, and as I believe, as Anshuman highlighted, the importance of the data. So in that case, do you see, how do you see this trend? Because see, these are not surface level automation tools, but these are more of a ETL tools like Talend or Acceptor or Alteryx. But they can do, data level transformation. So what do you see? What is the role and what is the space for such
tool tech? So you are right. I mean, I think already I've covered the people who are into data architect space. So this may even cover the ETL space or maybe the DBA. But what I see, the people who are, I mean, nowadays there are few tools that have emerged like anything. One of the tool is called Snowflake. Snowflake is one of the data mining tool. Data lake, you can create data lake on cloud, complete end-to-end solution. Databricks is another by the Spark. So of course, ETL is one of the most demanding, but as you said, it has recept, right? It has recept into data lake, maybe big data. So people who are there into this space, I think there will be more and more demand, I believe, Binay.
Not to forget Celonis. They are the market leaders now.
Yeah, so that is the process mining. Celonis is process mining. Yeah. So already I talked to you that how we should be starting our journey. So the first stage we can get started with RPA and then amalgamate RPA with Celonis, chatbot. Maybe you can learn about, you know, Alexa. Maybe you can go with NLP. You can go with, you know, NLP and then OCR, any of the OCR tool, you can take it up. And Celonis can be used to discover the challenges rather than the highly paid consultant or maybe your people business analyst interviewing or doing the value stream mapping. We can deploy, the enterprise usually deploy the Celonis or other Disco or maybe UiPath as its own native tool in order to discover the pain point and visualize it.
Yes, I think, Madan, I think tools like, you know, Discovery Bot or even Celonis, I think it is becoming, do you see that trend that it is becoming like a prerequisite for starting RPA? Because earlier, these tools were not in much existence or not matured enough, I would say. But then, you know, this process discovery, because if you choose the wrong process, then RPA definitely, you know, is a failure, right? So from that perspective, do you see it is becoming like a prerequisite or is it driven by budgets or how is it?
Binay, there is a big misconception between process discovery bot and and the process mining. Mm-hmm. So process discovery, it's a kind of bullshit. I mean, sorry to use the word.
Yeah, I understand.
So all these RPA vendors, they have released process discovery bot. What essentially it's doing, one of the agent is sitting on, you know, the process, the operation agent machine, and it's nothing but it's video recording what you are doing. And then they will mine it at one place. And then finally, they are saying, hey, look, these are the processes that can be automated. And finally, it's actually eliminating the plumbing work. What essentially people are dragging, dropping and automating the processes. 50-60% of the work is being accelerated, expedited. Mm-hmm. By mm-hmm. those things. This is great, but it's not matured enough. I mean, it's broken. It's create more frustration. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's better to bring the business champion, as you pointed out, from operation. They know where are the pain points, do the workshop, and that can be done.
Right.
But process mining is, and big enterprise has adopted process mining. So process mining approach is actually ingesting, you know, the logs from SAP, from Salesforce, from different, the enterprise applications, and then bringing out the X-ray view of your processes. And then you figure it out where is pain. So rather than you go by the human intuition, rather than you go by the gut feeling, you go by the actual data. It's a business analytics approach to discover your processes. So process mining is a very matured approach. However, process discovery, it's not suggestible to go with process discovery and waste your time and money, Binay.
Okay.
Any thought process.
Okay.
Yeah, Madan, yes, you're absolutely right. Just to add on to your point, that is an interesting subject. That's the reason I'm taking a lot of time from.
Oh, yeah, no, please go ahead. It's beneficial for all of us. Please go ahead. Yeah.
So Celonis is an excellent tool for process mining. As you said, that instead of depending on some information from the people, it is always good to get the data directly from the system, because what happens, and this is specifically for the finance domain, we have seen that people tend to do things in a way which is wrong, and they think that this is the right thing, and they don't say that this is one of the pain points.
Yeah.
But the tools like Celonis, they can identify that these are the pain points which are not I mean, you know, where we cannot have many of the IT tool or IT intervention. It could be simple Six Sigma or simple, you know, simple process improvement that can be done.
Yeah, you are right, Anshuman. Actually, rather than your people speak, let the data speak, right?
Absolutely, because data cannot be wrong.
Yeah, data cannot be wrong. People may be biased. People may be biased. You are right. Yeah. So what I have seen, I mean, I see a lot of people are not speaking. I don't know, maybe. But what I have seen, Anshuman and Binay, a lot of role emerging and demand for process mining consultant. I have seen not much, but I have seen in the past, in last 3 months, a few people approached me. Do you know somebody who are, you know, Celonis expert, maybe who can help us to transform Celonis, I mean, implement Celonis and in fact, close some of the deals. This is one of the role I have seen in the past that is emerging.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So any interesting insight with respect to job, how to upskill ourselves in 2021 to stay relevant and competitive from anybody? I see most of the people who are here, they are business leader. They are working one or another part of industry.
Hello, everyone. It's Sumant here. Thanks, Madan, for organizing this particular meeting, because I had a couple of questions with respect to, one is with the process mining. I'm a Celonis certified data analyst and data engineer. I wanted to know the, you know, insights from the industry experts itself, like how the industry is, you know, accepting the process mining Celonis tool, especially since I have heard that the Celonis the license is quite costlier than the other process mining tools. Can anybody give us some insights about this tool?
So I may take it up, but anybody else, Anshuman or anybody, have you experienced?
I'm qualified to answer.
Yeah,
but please. Then this gentleman has answered, answered his own question. Yes, Celonis is pretty difficult to sell from a consulting point of view. One of the main reason is of course lack of knowledge about what Celonis can do, and the second thing is of course the license cost, because the clients, they don't see the benefit. They want to, I mean, each and every client, they basically want to look into the ROI, look into the dollar value, which they can't see from Celonis. We as consultants, we try a lot to explain that what are the benefits and all those stuff. But then clients, I have personally seen 3 clients refusing straight away, even though they agree to the point that this is going to help.
I think you are right. You are right. This is pretty expensive. So it becomes very difficult as a selling point. But still, larger clients, I have seen they have adopted. I would like to tell one story about Vodafone. So it was very difficult to, I mean, though I was not involved, this is secondhand story. Vodafone has adopted a tool called Disco. It's FlixCon. The tool, this is cheaper than Celonis, but it has got very good, you know, the feature and pretty competitive as Celonis. So Disco, I mean, probably you can go back and study about Disco. That is a fantastic tool, and that flows, that it worked into Vodafone.
Madan, can you ping the tool name?
Yeah.
The website? Yeah.
I'm just giving you the link itself.
Thanks, Madan, for answering that. The second question which I had with respect to the Microsoft Power Automate, how is that shaping up? Basically, I'm a Blue Prism developer. Also, I'm a Celonis certified analyst. So I'm interested in how I can take in my journey forward with these two technologies And yeah, with that, how the Power Automate is shaping up.
So I'm qualified, Madan this side, I may answer, but I will open up from other participant here. I don't think so. Microsoft Power Automate is still mature to automate the enterprise level applications. Though they have procured, they have acquired, you know, Softomotive, but still integration making it matured may take another 1 year of time. So when you talk about UiPath, Automation Anywhere, Blue Prism, those are pretty mature tool, and they have a lot of success story, but still Microsoft has to do a lot of work in order to mature it. And it should take time. It should take time. But hopefully, I'm hoping they should bounce back because they have an incredible platform, Microsoft Azure. They should be integrating, but it's still not. Lot to go. Any other thought process from anybody here, expert?
Madan, what about WorkFusion? I mean, I don't see much action on WorkFusion as compared to it was earlier. So, do you see any?
I think almost they're flopped. I don't think so.
Right. Yeah, because I don't see much traction.
Almost they're flopped. And reason being, you know, Vinay, I know the story. WorkFusion was initially into Citibank, one of the largest bank, but I know the story. They tried to enter into Vodafone also. But the biggest problem with the WorkFusion, though it's economical, but it brings a lot of complexity.
Right.
Just to set up the WorkFusion, it's a nightmare. It's not easy to set up. You need Unix box, you need Windows box, you need blah, 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 so many things. And it was not mature tool. It was not mature tool. So I think it's flopped. Yeah. UiPath has actually, you know, taken all their market.
Right.
Yeah. But still, I mean, just to summarize the audience here, since though we are talking about hyper automation, intelligent automation, but somewhere the entire discussion looks like it's RPAfication, as Vinay rightly pointed out. RPA is not everything. And it's not a kind of silver bullet that will solve the problem. As being a business consultant, or maybe as being a strategic leader, when we enter into enterprise space to solve the problem, we have to look at the problem statement, challenges, and where we can apply what kind of tools or technology to solve in order to drive the business value to the customer. So RPA is one, NLP could be another, OCR could be another, computer vision could be another, process mining could be another. So there are many plethora of tools and technology into the enterprise landscape. Depends on the problem statement and depends on the urgency we have to apply. But end of the day, these all tools becomes kind of toolkit for ourselves, just like our strategic leader. Any comment, Vinay or Anshuman?
I agree with you.
So any other thought process before we conclude? This was for 1 hour, but I think this is amazing. Organizing such kind of sessions, talking to all of you, getting your perspective. Any other question or any other insights before we wrap it up?
One more question from my end. It's Sumant here. How has the IPN or the BPM tools, being integrated, or how it is getting evolved? Since I am seeing IPN has a lot of demand.
Vinay, you come from banking background. IPN has a lot of use cases in banking as a BPM. Would you like to take it up?
Well, yes, Sumant, I have heard about this tool, but unfortunately, I couldn't get into that kind of engagement. But yes, it is picking up pretty fast. That's what I am hearing. And another thing is, what about Pega? Because Pega has been there with their BPM as well as RPA offerings, right? But Pega, again, I also do not have first-hand experience, but I am hearing that it's quite expensive one, but at the same time can be stable. So any trends? Appian, yes, I do definitely hear, but you know, I'm yet to get into, you know, that space.
So my two cent, Madan, here, look here, Shuman, BPN, RPA 2 are two different, you know, ball game and strategy in order to automate your processes. BPM actually streamline your processes. So essentially mean that it can integrate a very good integration with your different systems. It can streamline your processes and automate. So streamline processes is altogether a different ball game. While RPA actually targets the human, whatever is the human intervention, transactional, actually your people are doing on top of whatever you have automated through the BPM. That piece of work can be automated using RPA. Otherwise, BPM is very, very strategic, very, very strategic, streamlining the work. However, RPA sits on top of your UI and it eliminates the human intervention. This is where it differentiates BPM and RPA. It works hand in hand. Now coming back to Pega, what Vinay has pointed out, Vinay, you are right. I mean, Pega is pretty stable, but it's pretty expensive. So why they are not able to, I believe, I mean, still there is a demand, but it's not so much emerged as UiPath, Blue Prism, Automation Anywhere has created a kind of, you know, the visibility into the market. Still, they are good in terms of their BPM and RPA tool.
Nice. Okay. I didn't want to take more time, but then talking about BPM and ITSM, I think again there is something which can be looked after by every technical guys. It's something called ServiceNow.
Really,
it has really grown.
Yeah, that's true. So that is the ITSM space. That is, I mean, ServiceNow has actually acquired a lot of market. I mean, almost it has finished this one. What is called
BMC Remedy.
BMC Remedy. Yeah.
Yeah.
Almost it has eaten away the entire market.
Correct.
Great. So people who are coming from IT, IL background, I mean, for them, ServiceNow will be a good choice in 2021 to get it into. There is another emerging field, Vinay, just to let you know, and Anshuman, everybody, AI ops.
Mm-hmm.
Artificial intelligence for IT infrastructure. The okay. people who are into IT, IL, or maybe the people who are into service delivery, they can also get it into AIS space.
Right.
Yeah, so this is emerging, and this is the next evolution of, you know, IT, IL and DevOps together.
Okay.
Yeah, great. So I think it's a good conversation. It's a good discussion. And I think I love to organize such kind of session, maybe bi-weekly, not very frequently, bi-weekly, just to hear it out, other perspective, where industry is heading.